Good afternoon and welcome to Resonance Arcade, everybody. It's Wednesday night and we are live.
Woo!
Hey. How is everybody?
Good. Good to be back.
Yeah.
Yeah,
been around for a while. I said last week was our first week back after probably about a month because we've all been on holiday. And today we've got Lou back. No, Steve, because Steve's got man flu, unfortunately.
Yeah, I give him man flu. I brought it back from Italy with me.
Well, there you go. That explains it all. Anyway, so hello to everybody who's watching. For those of you who haven't seen us before, you should know that this is a gaming talk show. We just generally talk about games that we've played during the week or the last couple of weeks, and gaming industry news, etc., things that have come out that have interested us. There's not loads at the moment, even though there are a few. There's a few things out. I think EGX was on last weekend. A few announcements from that, although to be fair, I haven't really looked that much about it.
It kind of feels like that refractory period after E3 where there's little bits coming out of the stuff that we already know. And anticipation's building, isn't it?
There's lots of little new things that keep coming out for Fallout 4. There's lots of little new things that keep coming out for, you know, the big games and the E3 announcements essentially. But yeah, it's not, I don't know, it's more of a what have we played, I think, at the moment, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah, for Fallout 4, I think they're periodically releasing the little special videos. So they've done, I think they did Endurance last week, and this week they've, I think, done Charisma, possibly. So they're doing like little animated videos, you know, with the sort of Pip-Boy cartoon character. And they're pretty good, they're pretty funny, I have to say. These are things that we're all familiar with if you played Fallout before anyway.
I haven't watched any of them because I know what I want. I know it's one of them games. I know that I want to play it. I don't want to spoil anything for myself. Simple as that, you know. I've never really been disappointed with that tactic, so I'm going to keep doing it.
I've not actually caught up in a lot of stuff from Fallout 4, but I'm anticipating it more now than ever. Like, the less I know about it, the more I want it at the moment. Which is the opposite to how I normally am with hyping games.
They've not released that much more than the original gameplay footage that we've already talked about from E3. They've not released that much more apart from these little special videos, which is no gameplay, it's just little cartoons.
There's been lots of little articles that have been done by various news outlets, but nothing kind of major, you know?
They're quite speculative, I think. There's not like concrete stuff being brought to the floor, as far as I can tell. Anyway.
Yeah, sorry, there's some there's a ruckus going on outside that I just muted for.
Go and stab him.
Some horrendous oiks making noise.
Yeah, so sorry if it keeps going, but you won't be able to hear the nasty swearing, etc. So yeah, traditionally we start off with talking about games we've played. I have not played loads of games, but I've played a few. Two new ones, in fact, and obviously Metal Gear Solid 5, which I've been hammering. But I think the rest of you haven't really played much else, have you?
I've only played Metal Gear.
I haven't played anything.
Such an awful state of affairs doing a gaming podcast and not playing any games.
I've got more to say about Metal Gear.
So let's talk a little bit about Metal Gear to get it out the way so Luke can...
Well, can I say something about Metal Gear?
Go on.
Having watched the previous episode, I am quite sold on Metal Gear Solid 5.
Yeah?
Because it seems to be a very different game. It's like what I think Steve kind of came around to it as well when you were doing it.
He did, yes.
And although maybe the story stuff, you kind of have to know what's going on. We do.
You don't.
Know what's going on because
you don't know.
Stories. So thin on the ground.
I guess, but you kind of have to have some background. Or maybe you don't have to have some background. It's nice to have some background to understand the world you've been dropped into.
One thing that we didn't talk about much last week is the cassette tapes. This is a way for the game to give you, drip-feed you little bits of backstory and narrative without having game-stopping cutscenes and codec calls. So you can see the size of the map that Chris is looking at here, as you're traveling from one place to another, you can pop these tapes on and just listen to things as you go, so you can get enough backstory about who Big Boss is, what Mother Base is, that kind of stuff. You can get all that from the tapes. You don't need to have played the other games. I mean, Lou, you've already seen us play, you've seen Chris play through Metal Gear 1, 2 and 3. You haven't seen 4, but this doesn't relate to 4, so don't worry about it, because 4's
I'm not
about
worried
Solid
about it
State,
at all.
Not Big Boss.
But it does seem like a very accessible game. Like, I could play this
it is.
In the same way that I play Far Cry 3.
It is. Well, it's basically Far Cry 3 crossed with Grand Theft Auto or Afghanistan, you know, kind of.
Grand Theft Auto.
Maybe not. Well, no, it is when you think about it.
Metal Gear, because there is still a lot of Metal Gear in there.
There is.
It's not a completely different game. It's just, it's not as esoteric as the other Metal Gear games have been, I should say.
I'm going to reiterate a point that I made last week, which is I like that it doesn't particularly punish you for not being stealthy, for being non-stealthy, if you know what I mean. You could run around with rocket launchers and guns and, you know, without silencers on and shoot the crap out of everybody if you really want to. Fair enough, you do get better, you know, better soldiers if you stealth it and you hold them up, you get better intel and things like that. But it still can be played as an action game, you know. And I like that. And I mean, even though I don't play it as an action game, I do try and play it as a stealth game generally. I like the fact that it doesn't punish you too much.
Yeah.
One thing I like about the action, the way that you can move into action and out of action, is that it feels quite organic. So if you're doing a main mission, you might want to get that S rank, perfect stealth, no kills, no reflex. That's fine. But if you're in there's these things called side ops, which is your little things like extract a guy from over here, take out these tanks, do that kind of thing.
Fulton in a tank right now, by the way.
Yeah, I know. I think I don't think the Fulton system is anywhere approaching reality. But
no, of course
it's cool.
Not.
It's cool as hell. I like it.
I didn't quite get what Fulton was. But it looks like you attach a balloon to vehicles and they float off.
And you send it off to your mother base, basically. Where you basically Fulton everything that's movable in the game. It's like living in Liverpool, essentially. Everything that can move can get stolen by yourself. But basically, you kidnap everybody in the game. You kidnap all of the soldiers and you send them to mother base to be brainwashed to follow you.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing that about the character, because you are ostensibly the hero or the protagonist, but yeah, what you are doing is taking Soviet and African PMC soldiers when you get to the African bit, and you are, yeah, you're taking them back, breaking them down and making them join your private military. In this private military that you're establishing now is the private military that Solid Snake destroys in the very first Metal Gear game, the old MSX one.
Hmm.
So we all know that you're essentially setting up Outer Heaven, which is this thing that Solid Snake goes into in the first, not Metal Gear Solid, but the first Metal Gear game.
So
you're establishing this military country that's just based on military force and arms and all that kind of shit.
Can you clarify which who you are in this? Are you playing Big Boss?
Boss,
are you? So you're Big Boss in this,
your
right?
Big Boss,
okay.
Who is the person you play in Metal Gear Solid 3, who is basically the super soldier that Snake, Liquid, Solidus are all cloned from.
Yeah.
And, or are you, though? I'm still not convinced that you're playing him.
I'm not either. The way the game starts makes it really ambiguous as to who you are. Now, it's not spoiling anything, because this is in the first 2 seconds of the game. Well, not the first 2 seconds, but the first bit of gameplay you actually get to do is another person in the hospital comes and helps you out, who's all wrapped in face masks but is also voiced by Kiefer Sutherland. So you've got your guy voiced by Kiefer Sutherland and this other guy helping you out who seems a lot cooler and harder than you, also voiced by Kiefer Sutherland. Now he voiced
but
him
he also says something, he also says are you you're looking at yourself or something to that effect, doesn't he?
Yeah, so there's a few little clues that make me think that we're not playing as Big Boss in this game, that we're playing as somebody who's been made to look and behave
or
like him.
Maybe you're a clone of Big Boss, or the first clone of Big Boss that's been something like that. I don't know. We just don't know. And to be fair, when I find out, I'm not going to spoil it either. I'm not going to tell anybody, because, I mean, I'm still miles away from the end.
Imagine it turns out that you actually Ocelot.
No, because Ocelot's...
in a mask.
I reckon Ocelot's your dad or something.
Ocelot's been really... He's been surprisingly unsurprising in this game.
So far.
He's very, very straightforward and not really done anything apart from give you genuine advice. He's not done anything dickish. He's not... He doesn't behave like the absolute bellend that he was in Metal Gear Solid 3. There's none of this. There's none of, like... There's none of that shit. He does it, like, one little bit in the beginning of the game, and then he just sort of stands around and goes, "Boss, we should get more men." That's basically like all he does. And I've 40% completed the game now, so it's very, very different.
The character you play looks and sounds actually from these actions to be quite an anti-hero.
He seems to be a bad guy, but
you're playing as the bad guy, so he seems like a good guy sort of thing.
To be fair, he's very, very ambiguous because he doesn't say a lot, as we said last week. He doesn't say much at all. Miller and Ocelot do most of the talking, and you just kind of grunt and go, yeah, all right, occasionally. And it's really different. It's really weird because you're not the same person. I mean, even when you played Solid Snake and you played Big Boss, they had similar traits. Obviously, David Hayter did the voices for both of them in 1, 2 and 3, and probably
Peacewalker.
I don't know. I haven't played Peacewalker yet, so I don't know if it is him or not, but I assume it is.
It is him. But, well, one thing I will say about the way that they characterise Big Boss in that he doesn't speak that much, but one thing I will say is I'm actually quite impressed with Kiefer Sutherland's performance. Not that I don't miss David Hayter, because I really do, but he does play him in this very sort of beaten down, world weary kind of way. Like, he talks about things with this sort of almost depressing finality to his decisions, as opposed to being like, kept you waiting, and all that sort of swagger that Big Boss and Snake have always had, which is the David Hayter like charm. He feels a little bit more broken and a bit more beaten down. Like, the way he talks he feels a bit more like, curse, we've got to do this. He's like, talks a lot more, it's a
like
lot more
Jack
down
at the end of the 24 hours.
Yeah, exactly. Which I think might have been a reason that they wanted Kiefer to do it, because he has that kind of, now that he's a bit older himself as an actor, he has that sort of sound to his voice. Mm. Which actually, I think, even though he doesn't speak very much, in the cutscenes that he has spoken in, has worked really well. And I was one of the people that was like, David Hayter or fuck off, you know. I've sort of come round to their decision a little bit more. I still wish that they found a way to get Hayter in and just given him better direction in the booth and made him be more subtle rather than not another actor.
I think they will. I reckon, are we going to meet Snake somehow? We have to. He cannot do the final Metal Gear game and not just remove the staple from it. There's going to be some big twist, and I bet someone's already found it. I bet we could spoil it by finding it online, but I've purposefully avoided everything Metal Gear.
There's something in the news article that isn't a spoiler, but it just talks a little bit about the Konami Kojima fallout, that there's people talking about some cut content from the game, that there's supposed to be maybe a couple of extra chapters that aren't actually in the game as it was bought. But apparently someone with the PC code has seen that it's one of those that's on the disc but not available to play. You have to sort of crack it. And then people are speculating, will it release later as DLC? Is the DLC going to be the true ending?
Yeah. People the Metal Gear Solid Hot Coffee mod, is it?
To be fair, you can pretty much do that anyway with Quiet.
Yeah, I saw a video of Quiet rolling around in some rain after jumping out of a helicopter.
I've got to make a few comments, few criticisms of the game. Last week I was like, this is the best game I've ever played ever. And it is still. One thing I forgot to mention is that I'm amazed how smoothly, I mean, this is horrific that I have to say this, but I'm amazed how smoothly it runs at such a high resolution. I'm running it, and I think it's at least 1440p. It's a one above 1080p or whatever as you can see on the screen. I've got it on letterbox mode, but this is me playing, by the way, but there's corners cut off, the sides are cut off, because I've got a true 4K monitor, and it's only in, the resolutions are only available in normal UHD 4K, and its derivatives, so I might have to do it like that. But I'm amazed how smoothly it runs. It runs at 60 FPS constantly, and I've not had a crash at all, or a bug I've come across, really. I mean, I know there are a few, I've got, again, some links in the news to paste later on. A few people have complained about bugs, save-breaking bugs, in fact. And there's lots of warnings all over the front of the game whenever you start it up that keep popping up and saying, during the FOB tutorial or during missions 48 and 49 while you're playing with Quiet, this might happen and break your save. I haven't come across any of that yet, thank God.
So the game warns you of possible softlocks?
Yeah, it's basically Konami just saying, we know about it, we're going to sort it, we're sorting it out ASAP, just we haven't got around to it yet. And they tend to be pretty consistent with releasing the patches and the bugs for every platform as well. And everything's working. I haven't had a single blue screen, I haven't had a single overheat, I haven't had a single, really, I mean, occasionally if something mad happens on the screen, I get a bit of a frame drop. I'm running at a pretty high res with full settings, and it looks nice. Don't get me wrong, it's not the best looking game on the planet, but it looks really nice. And I'm amazed. I'm really proud of Konami for doing this, you know?
Certainly the Japanese don't have a track record of making good PC games in the sense of them being, you know, bulletproof, well made, set up for controls and stuff like that. They tend to make... I played the first Dark Souls on the PC and that was awful.
This is a console franchise though.
Yeah.
That's come out on PC at the same time as consoles. And it's sad. I know, it's really sad that I'm making a point of this. But it's brilliant at the same time that it's worked so well. And it works consistently well. I said, you might have just saw then on the screen, I actually got stuck on a rock. I was trying to jump down off about an inch of a rock and I got stuck. That's the only real, you know, few collision issues that I see. Real problem that I come across.
There are a couple of things about the way it's designed, like in particular in Afghanistan, there are a lot of sections of the game that are just a pain in the arse to navigate. You basically got certain rocks that you cannot climb over, and there are certain to get to certain places in the game, like that base that you just went past there. If you're in a car and you've not got D-Walk or anything, you cannot drive past that place to get to where you need to go without being seen, unless you get out of the car and leave it behind, which negates the purpose of having a car. That's just bad like design. The fact that there's not a way to get around that in your car.
You can get around it. There's two different... you can go around each side, but you have to be quite lucky that a guard isn't looking at you at that time.
Yeah, I've tried getting around it in Jeeps, and it's never worked.
This mission that I'm doing now, this is quite a long mission, but I'm trying to S-class it. I think I do get an S-class at the end of this. But every single time I went past that base, I got seen, but then I changed my tactic and I basically took out a few of the guards that were wandering around the front of the base at the very beginning of the mission before I actually started going past the base back and forth. And there's also other tactics you can use, like don't go past the base, sit in a specific area and wait for all the enemies to come along.
See, this is nice. This reminds me, actually, of when Steve and I played Syndicate Wars, and that you would try tactics which you think would work, or you'd try things and think, there's no way that I can do this without doing this, and then you find another way to do it. It's really rewarding when you can do that. So
there's a million different ways
to do things. There really is. I've now got quiet with a full silenced sniper rifle. I've now got myself with full silenced everything, all tranquilizers, so I can basically take... I've got like a Fulton of, I think it's about 48 Fultons I've got in my pack, so I can Fulton everything in a level, you know, before I need a resupply. One thing I'm looking forward to is the handgun infinite suppressor that you can get.
Yes, the tranquilizer. I'll be using that as soon as I can. And the other bugbear that I have with the game, apart from the fact that I do think I don't mind the fact that there's not much story because I'm enjoying the gameplay so much, which I did say last week. A lot of Metal Gear fans have gone, you know, it's really not much story in this, and the story that's there is disappointing. I can't really say that because I've not completed it yet. But the fact that the game world is so large and that there's not really a properly implemented fast travel system, you can get the helicopter to come and pick you up. But when you get in the helicopter, you then go up out of the mission area, then you go cut to you sat in a helicopter shot. Now, if you want to go back somewhere, you pick somewhere and go down again. And that whole process takes like 2 minutes.
Yeah.
That's not a fast travel system. You can get in cardboard boxes and get delivered to certain points, but only if you've not raised any kind of alert in that base.
And also,
in this game, if they just see you and go, huh, that's an alert. Like, the base is then on alert.
Again, not always. You can...
Pretty much. If they see someone get Fultoned, or they notice somebody asleep, or any little thing that you've done, you can immediately can't fast travel from that base, and it's really fucking annoying.
That's not an alert. That's an awareness.
Doesn't matter. The base is on alert. It's on gun orange. You can't use the box. fast travel system.
But only if you, if this one guy that's just seen you, you can you can he'll walk towards something. If he, as long as he doesn't actually spot you, you can it'll disappear quickly. It'll turn back and you can use your cardboard box immediately.
Yeah, the point I'm trying to make here is that there should be an easy, I want to fast travel now.
Like, I agree.
You've got a huge open world. Make fast travel a part of it. It just should be. You should be able to call the helicopter and just say, right, get in a helicopter, drop me down at another landing spot. I don't know why you can't do that.
I know, it is really, that is quite annoying that it now that takes I've put, like, so long.
I've put over 50 hours into the game now, and that's grinding on me a bit. Like, when I want to just get around the map, I don't want to have to drive 2.5 kilometers.
You know, if you call D-Walker in, though, you can pretty much scale the entire map in a few minutes.
Yeah,
if
I
that.
Know.
And to be fair, the same goes for the vehicles. Even they're a little bit slower, but you can still entire crates you can fulton as well. Brilliant. You can pretty much just get to the other side of the map pretty quickly, especially in somewhere like Afghanistan. Africa.
Africa's easy to get around.
You proper fly across things. But there is some choke points in Africa as well, and you get to know where the enemies are going to be roughly. And you know, sometimes depending on what buddy you've got with you, it depends on how aware you are as well. Because even though Quiet's really good buddy, I find that she doesn't always see everybody if you send a scout in somewhere.
No, D-Dog's the best for that.
D-Dog's easily the best, yeah.
D-Dog's my favourite buddy so far. He's awesome.
There you go. I've just been seen by this guy now. Right, he's coming round. There's two guys who've seen me, in fact. He's coming round, but if I keep away from that and hide, like I'm going... I'm not actually sure if I get seen now.
I didn't mean whenever a guard sees you. If you do anything, like if you were there, if you shot out one light bulb or if you blew up that thingy there, the base would then go on alert for several minutes, meaning that you can't fast travel from there.
Right,
it doesn't take a lot to make the base alerted enough that you can't fast travel.
No,
and they
right,
stay in
right.
that for a long time.
Oh, I might be dead here.
There you go, Chris Special. He's going to shoot everyone with a machine gun.
Hey, look, it's been a good... how many minutes now?
Since
I've
died.
Been stealthing it up for a good 20 minutes here. Thank you very much.
The things that I've said there that are negatives, that's like the two negatives that I have out of a game that I consider to be fucking brilliant. Like, it's an awesome experience. I'm enjoying it a lot. Quite addictively so, like... But no game is perfect, and it does have its issues.
What looks really nice to me as well, coming from my constant bugbear with movement systems in games, is something you said last week and something I'm watching again here, is that the movement seems very sharp and fluid.
There's obviously
no like waiting for animation to finish while his inertia turns him round and stuff. It's just really like almost like a first-person shooter kind of control.
With a mouse and keyboard. Well, there is a first person. When I always put my first person, I turn my first person on, so every time I'm firing, if I've got my pistol out or I've got any gun, it's through the iron sights or through the red dot sight or whatever sight I've got attached to the weapon I've got. It's very, very customizable as well. There's lots and lots of little things to do. Lots of micromanagement if you really want to micromanage. If you don't, you can just like literally send, you know, set up your base to use all the defaults. And it still works all right. I mean, I've not had any detriment from doing that. But if you do really want to go, right, this guy needs to be in my support unit or whatever, you can put him in there.
I'm still continually impressed by the evolution of the AI. The further you get in the game, the more cottoned onto your tricks the enemy gets. Like now, I've got to the point where the enemies are now looking for Fulton balloons. So I think, they won't see me. Because when you start the game, the enemies aren't that switched on to what Fulton is. So they sort of look at the guys and go, what's going on? Whereas now they're like, bang, shoot the balloon. And you're like, god damn it.
Yeah.
I have to like put 16 other guys asleep to get this one guy out. Which is cool. It makes the game more challenging. I love all that. Like, the AI gets more... It progresses as you progress. So even though you're going through a lot of the same places again, you're encountering different obstacles when you get there, which is one of the ways I think they've kept the game interesting as it's gone on.
You also build up your bond level with all your buddies as well, and as your bond level gets bigger, you get more commands that you can use them with. So, for example, you can set your D-Dog on enemies and he can distract a certain set of enemies, but if there's too many around, he'll get shot to hell, so he'll get killed and get fultoned out, and it'll cost you 50 bloody million GMP or whatever. And
expensive for a dog.
I even find things like when you do have an alert, I change the way that I play immediately, and I start sprinting everywhere, and I start like throwing people at walls and CQCing people, and I try
just
not...
like you do in the others.
No, but it's actually
kick 3,000 people to death.
I don't die that often in this game, though, and you know it's pretty difficult, but there's a lot of tactics you can use to, you know, to mitigate your life loss, I suppose. One other bugbear I've got, and I haven't got many in this game, is when you're on Mother Base and you're running around and you're collecting diamonds, or you're doing R&D, sorry, not the R&D, any of the training missions, or you're collecting posters, or you're doing things in Mother Base. If you die, accidentally fall off the R&D platform or something like that, because I've done that quite a few times, I have to be honest. If you die, all of the diamonds you've just picked up would just disappear. Like, even if you've been doing it for hours, there's no save points unless you use a cardboard box to move around. And it's just, it's a right pisser.
I haven't died on Mother Base. I'm kind of amused that you have died at Mother Base.
Have you been, it doesn't happen until quite late on. I've only had one of them so far, but an invasion on Mother Base.
Yeah, done that.
Okay, so I've just recently did that, and I unfortunately got to the very last guy, and he bloody shot me in the face, and I died. And I'd literally stealthed my way all the way there. He alerted because somebody came around a corner, and I was like, ah! Shot me in the face, and I missed it. So I don't know what happens when you win on Mother Base so far.
I'll find out. You have to find out. I think once you've done that mission and failed it, it's then available in your mission list to go and try again.
Oh, I didn't see.
I failed it the first time as well. I got shot to death by loads of guards because I was trying to rush.
I'll have a look then. It was only last time I played, I think, so I might not have even looked in my mission list since I failed it.
All right.
There's a little bits of XCOM going on here then with base invasions. It's quite a nice feature.
Yeah, and it's quite interesting because Mother Base is quite intricate as well, and Mother Base is what you make it because you build all the platforms, even though you don't customize the buildings on the platforms, and you just say, right, I want to build this extra platform for more availability within a unit, for example. You want to up your...
Does the base physically change when you add stuff to it, then?
Physically adds extra platforms onto this. You know, you've got this big oil rig type thing.
Yeah, is it a bit like Metal Gear Solid 2, I believe?
It does. In fact, it's when the default colour is the same colour. It looks like the Metal Gear Solid 2 big shell. You can change the colour of it. Mine's like blue now. But it starts out that bright orange colour from Metal Gear Solid 2.
Cool.
I'm just seeing if I've got a Mother Base thing. I probably don't, to be fair.
But yeah, there's the whole base management system is really good as well. I really quite like it. You've got intel team, medical team, combat team, support unit. What's the other one? Security you get later.
Yeah, I haven't yet got security, but yeah, I can see it coming.
And then you extract all the guards to do that, and you can send them out on missions. Your intel team will tell you if there's things nearby. You know, they'll scout enemy, like those little red circles you can see on the map is enemy predicted field of movement, which the intel team gives you as you level them up. So all these things just give you more tools and more stuff to use in the world.
Do you know what I think would be a really great twist in this game?
Bit of a stealth entry there. I just shot a sniper in the face.
a really, really, really great twist, I think, in this game would be towards the end, or right near the end, suddenly it changed so that you were playing someone trying to infiltrate this empire that you've built through the rest of the game, so you switch sides.
That's Metal Gear 1.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is the story of Metal Gear 1.
That's exactly
would be pretty cool, wouldn't it? If you invest all of your time and effort into making this really great base with all of these facilities and stuff, and then at the end of the game it pits you against what you built.
Well,
I wouldn't be surprised if something like that doesn't happen, I'll be honest.
Well, it's funny you should mention that, because one of the online components, and I should mention that I have not yet set up a PS Plus account on my PlayStation, so I haven't done any online gaming on my PS4.
It's not available yet anyway.
Not Metal Gear Online, I'm talking about forward operating bases. So you've got Mother Base, you can then purchase another basically an online mother base that's called a forward operating base. You can build that up, and then part of the online thing that you can do before Metal Gear Online even is released is people can invade your other base and try and nick resources off you, and you can do it to other people. So that online component is already available, as far as I'm aware.
It says all over the tutorial stuff and all over the intro, you know, the warnings at the beginning of the game, it says FOB mission during the FOB tutorial, this and this. I haven't found anything to do with it, unless it's on the menu.
I've just unlocked it, so it could be you have to do a certain. I think you have to do a certain story mission to unlock it.
You have to play 80 or 90 hours of the game before that opens up, because I'm about that.
I'm up to mission. I think I've done main mission 24 now.
I'm miles ahead of that.
Well, I've got the option when I go to base development. It says purchase waters and start a forward operating base. I've already got that option, so I don't know what's going on. Maybe it's a side op, but. If you're further ahead than me, then you should have already had that.
I've done hundreds of side ops, and I must be on 30. I must be in the 30s on the main missions, I think.
But what it looks like, you've got more advanced gear than I have, so you must be further than me in the game.
Well, have you got the weapons expert yet?
Yeah, but you've got your Fulton systems better than mine. You've got the three balloon thing, I don't have that yet. So
I've got all of my extra devices, my iDroid device, my Fulton, the scope, everything is all maxed out on mine. All five or six devices that you've got. But I haven't... Yeah. One thing... Oh, right. You know Quiet's extra armor?
Yeah.
The blood, the naked blood, and the naked gold.
Is there any point to it?
No. There is no point to it. It does fuck all, and it costs you a fortune to buy... And it costs you a fortune to deploy as well. Like when
it's
you
just
deploy,
aesthetic.
It costs you about 30,000 or 40,000 GMP just to deploy her with gold skin, and that's it. Does nothing. So I've just removed it, and I'm a bit pissed off. I've got to be honest with you. It's like, yeah, great fan service, excellent, but at least make it so she's a bit more accurate. Or imagine she's nails, isn't she? She's very accurate, or she shoots quicker, or something. You know, I don't know.
I find her really creepy because I've seen the model that she's based on who looks very much like her
face.
It's like a weird face on top of this, like a lifeless cast of a face on top of this exaggerated body.
Well, she's not really human, so that kind of explains that a little bit.
I just find her very creepy.
She's a cypher agent, or she's some kind of cypher. We don't really know much. I don't know much about her yet.
I've not had that much of her story revealed yet. I think... Once you get her loyalty up, I think her story will get done in little bits, I think.
I've got 100 bond with her. I've had it for quite a while and I haven't yet seen her. But apparently she disappears at some point, so it's like an Ares thing, I think, you know. You build her up, and then she just fucks off in the story and you're like, mate, really? Come on.
I like Quiet, but I like D-Dog better. So
I like Quiet for most of the missions, but if I'm doing any infiltrations, D-Dog's with me.
Yeah.
Quiet's actually really, really useful when you get the tranquilizer rifle.
Yes, it's very
silence
useful.
Tranquilizer, especially because you can literally just set her on cover me, and she'll just nail everybody, and nobody will know where she is, and she won't get shot at. She won't get they'll keep looking for her. They'll all run towards her position, and then she'll move. Before she even gets shot, and then she'll just keep fucking moving, and you're just brilliant because you can just infiltrate a base without killing anybody or touching anybody.
She's nigh on invincible as well, which is very helpful.
But she's not. She's been killed a few times on mine. Again, if you've got the
really,
yeah, if you've got the if you don't have a silencer with her and you set her just randomly firing on cover, have you got the cover me option yet?
Yeah.
So if you set her on cover me and you don't have a silencer with either the lethal or the non-lethal rifle, she'll get nailed. But if everybody runs towards her and they all get to her before she manages to move, which does happen in some places, she'll just get shot and then Fultoned out.
I've never had that happen. She's always managed to move, or I've engaged them and drawn them back to me.
Yeah, like, well, I haven't been. I just left them to it.
Whenever I see them all, like... shooting at her, I'm like, well, now that you turned away, I'll just shoot you in the head. Tranquilizers, of course.
Yeah. Anyway, should we move on from Metal Gear Solid?
Yeah, you know.
Because we could talk about it all day, and I'm sure nobody else cares about it apart from
I'm
us.
Pretty sure I'm going to buy this game.
It's wonderful.
It really looks really good.
I'll give you, I mean, I already said this last week, but I will warn you about the introduction. It's something you have to just power through it. Once you get to the proper open world and the mother base stuff, you'll be away. You'll be loving it probably.
It's pretty cheap as well. I mean, I got it for about 30 quid.
I've seen it for about 30 quid.
It was probably a little bit cheaper actually when I got it, but I really do think it's worth it. And I really do think you'd enjoy it as well.
I think I would as well.
It's a very good game, but I have to say, after about 80 or 90 hours as I've been playing, it's a little bit, it's starting to get a little bit draggy. Like, because I'm nailing every side op as soon as they become available, then moving on to the main missions, opening more side ops. In fact, there's quite a few times where you go back to your ACC, your Aerial Command Center, which is your... Basically, when you get in your chopper, it takes you off. This is what Sam was talking about with the 2 minutes thing. It takes you off into your ACC area. The interface changes a little bit. You can manage mother base and customize weapons and do kinds of other stuff. At that point, you get... forgotten where I was going with that. Brain just melted.
I don't know. Something about... You were going to warn Lou about with the game.
I said it's getting a little bit same. Once you've got into your ACC, it just feels a little... once you got into your ACC, that was it. The side ops then unlock again. So you could go into your ACC a number of times in between main missions, and it'll unlock more and more and more and more side ops. Sometimes it stops unlocking them, so you then move back onto the main mission. So I'm playing it like that, completing all the side ops that I possibly can. Then I'm going onto the main mission. Then the main mission again opens up another 10 side ops or whatever. I complete all 10 of them, and then occasionally I redo other side ops if I come across them as I'm going between side op locations. And you have to go back from between Afghanistan and Africa as well quite a lot to do them all.
Yeah.
And it's... You don't have to, but... I'd want to. I have to play it like that personally. And it's maybe, I don't know,
you're Mr. Side Quest, aren't you? You have to complete everything and have nothing left on the map.
I'm a bit of a completionist on that sense, but I'm not the kind of completionist that has to complete everything with an S rank, for example. I probably won't do that. I'll just get what S ranks I can, and if I really, really fancy doing a mission to completion, you know, I'll do that, but no.
Yeah, I quite like getting the... each mission has a main objective, but there are extra like ancillary objectives that you can discover on the first time round if you really want to. But you can then go back and replay missions and do extra little bits like get this prisoner from this certain bit or extract this tank or things like that that aren't part of the main mission, but there's like... It could often be seven objectives to a mission where there's only one main thing, which is like take out this guy. But you might have another six optional things that you could do for each mission, which gives them replayability. Because if you've got an S rank first time round, you can then go back, spend more time and do the extra bits. Or vice versa, if you've done all the extra bits, then go through it fast and get an S rank. Because speed and stealth is what gets you an S rank, basically. Do it as fast as you can, don't get spotted, don't kill anybody. S rank.
There's one mission, I think, is mission 8. And it's when it's in Afghanistan and you have to... kill a colonel, or you have to take a colonel out, but also stop his tank unit as they're going through a village. Now, the first time I did that mission, I infiltrated the whole village, and it took me like about an hour to clear the village out properly, get all of the materials and everything, clear the village out, set a load of mines on the road, and then wait, and then basically kick off the... you have to pick some intel up, and that kicks off him coming down the road in the tanks. First time I did it that way. Second time I went into it, I thought, well, what happens if I go the opposite way? So I went the opposite way down the road. His tanks have already spawned down the other side of the road. So I just put ENM mines down in front of the tanks. Nailed the tanks, full-toned the tanks away, and that was it. I completed the mission with an S rank. Didn't do anything. I was like, fucking hell. It took me about 2 minutes to do it as well. And there must be lots of little things like that you can do, I imagine.
There are. It's a good game.
It is. Okay, so, other games. Anyone else got a game they want to talk about? Lou, have you played anything at all?
I have played any game whatsoever, I'm afraid.
Not even a casual game, no?
Not even a casual. I've not been on my computer for 3 weeks, nearly.
Crikey.
Really? It's horrific. Have you got any games you want to talk about?
Not really, no. I've been completely out of the loop with games, unfortunately. But I've got this feeling that I really, really want to play some games. You know, when you've not played games for a while and you're just like, I really want to play games that I played before, and you know you'll fire them up for half an hour and then stop playing them.
Mm.
But yeah, you need to, really need to scratch that itch. But I'm just looking forward to some of the new stuff that's coming. I'm really looking forward to Fallout 4, especially. It's a game I feel I can lose myself in again.
Yeah, I'm hoping it... Well, I know it's going to be good. I don't even need to hope. I think it's going to be pretty good.
I'm looking forward to Fallout as well. I think when that one comes out, I think that'll be all four of us will probably all get that and all talk about it. Because I think Steve's up for it as well, so I reckon that'll be an all-round topic of discussion that everyone can get involved in. Which would be good, actually, because if we could all put our input on it, a bit like with the Witcher stuff, where we've all had a go at it. So what day is that release? Is that like the
November, isn't it?
Summer.
Is it November? I think it was, I think it was October. All right,
no, it's November, so November.
I think the 11th or something.
Anyway. Cool. Well, until then, we'll keep our excitement up for Fallout 4. But there's nothing much else big between now and then. I don't know when that Star Wars game is out, but I'm a little bit waiting for the reviews on that one anyway, the Battlefront game.
Yeah, I actually saw some news about that, which was that there's no server browser in the game whatsoever. So you can't choose which server you go on. The best you can do is you can party up with people and you might get on the same server. But it seems to be death. It seems to be death to any sort of gameplay with people that you know, which is really off-putting for me.
That's a really stupid misstep for them to make. I mean, one of the points about a game, especially a game like Star Wars, which is like this collective experience of people, is like you want to play it with your friends or at least have the option to. I don't know why they would not have that.
This is as an option. Yeah. This is the voice of all gamers everywhere, but they're not putting it in.
I'm not even into online gaming, but on principle, that's a stupid like problem that they've given themselves. Oh well.
So yeah, you can't choose your server, unfortunately.
Sorry, what's that for?
This is Battlefront, Star Wars Battlefront. There's no server browser in the game.
Which... You just get plunked into a...
You just get stuck on good server.
Isn't that like most of the console FPS games?
It is, but... Well, yeah, I guess it is. I mean, you can party up with people, but it's not guaranteed that you will get on a server with your party.
There was some game that I was looking at the other day, that it might have been today, actually, and it was basically it put you in random servers normally, but you could select it so you could choose a private, not a private server, you could choose a server with your friends.
Yeah, that you can't do that with this.
Grand Theft Auto Online, you can do that, can't you? If you've made a gang... You can then choose to get on a server with the rest of your gang if you want to.
There's got to be they'll do a party system like they do for Xbox Live.
They will, yeah. There is a party system, but I think because of the amount of resources the servers take or whatever, I don't know the official reasoning, but basically the big news was there is no server browser. There's no way to select a server.
Yeah, which
it's pissed people off.
To be fair, there's a lot of things coming out about Battlefront that people are getting a bit pissed off with already, so I imagine when it comes out they're going to have a lot to say about it, aren't they?
Yeah. I think that's just EA all over though, isn't it?
I don't know, EA do a good job sometimes.
There is an overwhelming sense that EA hate the gamer though.
I think there's a lot of... yeah, alright, maybe. I don't know, I think I've got a bit more respect for EA as a huge games developer than quite a lot of other huge game developers, but only because Ubisoft. Probably because I don't play that many EA games, and the ones I have played, I've quite enjoyed. But I don't know. The whole Battlefront thing is it just seems like a bit of a mess up front. It seems like they're really trying to push the console side of things again, and they're not really paying much attention to the PC gamers.
Well, you have to bear in mind that it will be intending for it to be part of their big Episode 7 onslaught of Star Wars media. If they've got a game coming out, which I think it's November as well for Battlefront. Could be wrong, but then the film's out in December. So the point is that they want like that winter to be. They want a big game. They want a big movie. They would be wanting it all out at the same time, and they want like an onslaught of Star Wars media because that's how they do these things. I'm not getting anything against that per se,
But if it means the detriment of the game, then it's a problem.
I think a lot of people are going, oh, it's not like the old Battlefront. Which it isn't. It's very much not like the old Battlefront. You know, it's smaller arenas. You can't... They're not having space battles in it, which were... I really enjoyed in the original Battlefront. I think they introduced me to Battlefront 2, actually. Go on.
It's just a misstep that it's called Star Wars. Like, put fucking space battles in the game.
You know what was cool about the space battles? You basically started off in a Star Destroyer or on you started off on an Imperial ship and on a Rebel ship, and you could get in fighters, but you could also defend the base as well. So you could get in a fighter and go out and fight space battles and shoot and take over various areas in space, but you could also attack the enemy base and take out generators, like I love doing in all them kind of games.
And you and your bloody generators.
I loved it. And they could have done them a bit better, a bit more elaborate. You know, the way it wasn't particularly complicated, but I still enjoyed it. You know, I still really liked them. But they're saying that they're not doing this so they can focus on the core elements, they can focus on the lore. But these are huge development teams, surely. They've got the time and the resources to put into these big licensed games, you know. Don't know.
This is why I'm wondering if it's the time frame is the factor.
Well, the release date is November the 20th for the EU version, so
there you go. Which is about a month before the film comes out, so they'll want it in that pre-Christmas bit. Yeah. That's a big deal for publishers as well. This will probably be a little bit of a factor into why there's this possible cut content in Metal Gear Solid as well. They'll just be like, it has to be out before Christmas, and it has to be out between basically the end of summer and Christmas so that we can make more money from it. Because it's a big deal. Every kid asks for a game for Christmas, don't they, these days?
Every kid, every adult as well, thank you very much.
Yeah, but you're likely to just go out and buy it yourself if you're an adult, aren't you? If I want a game, I go out and buy it. I don't ask my mum to get it for Christmas.
I do sometimes. I just depends on how many games I've got on my games wish list, you know?
Fair enough. But that's a big deal. That's why Assassin's Creed has that issue where they always shit a game out every November, because they have to get it in for that Christmas release window, and that's the same with Battlefront, unfortunately. I guarantee it'll be that.
Yeah, and I hope they do it justice, because it is a loved fit, you know, it's a loved game, the Battlefront and Battlefront 2. They did very well, and they had a lot of following. They had I wouldn't even say niche, it was quite popular back in the day. I don't know if you two played either of them.
Nope. No, I think I saw you played it once and thought it looked really cool, but I didn't get it on my PlayStation because I knew it wouldn't be as good as the PC version.
Yeah, well, it wouldn't have been. Okay, so another game I've been playing recently, which I've been thinking about playing for a while, and it is free to play, was Hearthstone. Now, to those who don't know what Hearthstone is, where have you been, for one, but two, it's a very, very, very popular trading card. Is it even trading? It's a card game.
It's an online card game, yeah.
Written by Blizzard, and it's in the World of Warcraft universe. I've been meaning to have a go for so long, it hurts, but I knew it'd be one of those games that I kind of get addicted to and not really have time to put into it, and I thought there was micropayments involved as well. I'm not even sure if there are micropayments, I'll be honest. but I've had a go, and I quite enjoyed it, but I don't think I'm going to get addicted to it. I think I'm quite chuffed about that as well.
How does it compare to Gwent?
Well, that's why I wanted to play it, because I wanted an offline Witcher 3 kind of version of Gwent. It's it's not the same game, obviously. It's not even remotely the same. Now, there's going to be some Hearthstone players out there that tell me how wrong I am here, because I've only played really the tutorial so far. I haven't played against anybody.
An expert opinion we've got coming here.
Yes, definitely. As the guy's playing now is Total Biscuit, who's a fairly well-known online kind of UK Brit critic, and he plays it quite a lot. He does top competitions with it and does judging and all kinds of stuff, so he knows what he's doing. Again, I don't think he's particularly professional or anything like that, but he knows what he's doing when it comes to, you know, the game and how to play it. But essentially, you have, so far anyway, it's all unlocking for me as I go through the tutorial, but you have an attack rating and a defense rating for each card, and every round or every turn you put down however many cards you've got mana for. So you've also got a mana rating for each card. So if you see at the bottom there, they've got 8, 4, 5, 1, 5, 2, 5. That's the mana, how much mana it costs to play that card. You've got one mana at the beginning of the round, and you work all the way, you know, 10 rounds, you've got 10 mana, 11 rounds, you've got 11 mana. You get one per round. And you can play combinations of whatever cards you've got that fit the mana, but all the cards have got different attack and defense ratings, and all the cards have also got different skills and different things that play. As you like, you might draw a card, it might draw two more extra cards. You might draw a card and it buffs all your other cards up. And so it's quite tactical. There's quite a lot of crazy kind of strategy elements in it, and this is why it's a competition game. This is why it's an esports game that people play. I'm going to keep giving it a go, I think, because I'm still just in the tutorial. I still need to, and God knows how many years late I am with it, to be fair. But I might have a go online, see if I get anywhere. I probably get my ass handed to me with it. After
you
get
your ass handed to you.
I will. Yeah. I
want to. The problem I've got with these card games is I want these units to move around the board and attack each other. I don't want to be in a situation where I'm just putting a card on a table against someone else's card on a table.
Well,
like, I want there to be more dimensions than just that.
Well, no, that's the thing. If you want to play a card game, play a card game. If you want to play a strategy game with models, play a strategy game with models.
The two
different things that share some similarities. There's loads of extra things with this as well. Every card does something different. You can attack using your hero card as well. You've got a special hero power. You've got cards that allow you to maybe attack three times with your hero per turn, or other cards that put other cards to sleep. Or, you know, when you draw a card as well, they're asleep for the first round, so they can easily get wiped out that round by the other player. So it's very, very tactical. And I think playing it wouldn't really work with models, because your cards can be short-lived, or they can last for rounds and rounds and rounds. You can have another, I just remembered another card, you can have a decoy card you can put down that makes the enemy have to attack that card. So they can't attack other cards. So say, for example, you put a card down with one defense, but then you put another card down with five defense that's a decoy, and then the enemy plays a three defense card, a three attack card, sorry. That three attack card will have to attack the three defense, but the one... the other card that you've played that can't get attacked might be buffing the other card. And, you know, there's all kinds of tactics you can play with it. And I think there's all kinds of extra cards you can draw as well when you play games and when you win games. And I don't even know if there's a trading element to it yet. I'll figure that out as I play it a little bit more. But, I mean, I've been playing Infinity Wars a little bit previous to this. And this is, I think it's an indie trading card game. And I've played a few physical card games over my life, and I've quite enjoyed them when I played them, but I don't really have people to play them with physically, so playing online might be a good escape for me, I think. And I'm sorry to those who are professionals at Hearthstone. I'm certainly nowhere near that, and I doubt I ever will be, but I, you know, so far it's captured my imagination. At least it's even given me ideas for other games that I've got going on at the moment.
Interesting, it was made in Unity.
Was it?
Yeah. Oh,
interesting, cool. That is interesting. So yeah, I mean, after playing this, and after I've recently finished a contract in my real work, I've actually started developing my own game, which is it's a hybrid between another game on top of the other game that I'm doing. It's a hybrid between a trading card game and a roguelike, kind of like FTL type thing. And if there's a game called Plague Inc., which I've been playing quite a lot, which is a casual game that you have to basically, you're a virus and you have to take over the entire world and wipe all 7 billion people on the planet out. And it's really, really fun. It's hella fun, in fact. It's one of those, it takes about, I don't know, 20 minutes to complete a game, but it's quite good to play. So yeah, I'm enjoying it. Have you played it at all, Lou?
Nope.
No. Well, at least I did a bit of talking on it then. it's one of those games that I think a lot of people watch on Twitch as well. A lot of people kind of go, oh, that was a good move. Oh, I liked how you did that, you know, but you have to really know how it works in order to beat, in order to really
participate.
Are we talking
about Hearthstone?
Hearthstone, sorry, yeah. Yeah. Still,
no,
still
I'm not interested in online card games at all.
Well, anyway, it was... I am quite interested. I really want to get into something like Magic the Gathering and, you know, physical.
You want to own a pristine Black Lotus?
A what?
It's like one of the famous cards from Magic the Gathering.
Is it?
Clearly, no. I know more about it than you, and I don't even like card games. Jesus Christ.
One of my good friends is really into it, but he's every time I ask him to explain it, he never does. He's like, oh.
It's very similar to Hearthstone, I guess.
Yeah.
There's lots of cards because it's been around for decades.
Yeah. Okay. One other game I've been playing today, and only because somebody on Twitch posted it, and it's been around a while, is agar.io.
Agar, maybe?
Agar, sorry, it is agar.io. It's an online web game, and it's essentially... Let me try and find a link to it. Probably got a...
I clicked the link and there's no description of what the hell the game is.
No, there isn't, but that's one of the good things about it. It kind of throws you into it. Basically, it's Spore, the first stage of the game Spore.
Right.
You run around and you eat particles and you get bigger and bigger and bigger. And that's the idea of this game, but there's two commands that you've got. You can either fire or emit matter. And if you emit matter, it just makes you smaller. Or you can split yourself into two. So, in fact, let me...
Explain the name agar, by the way, because agar's the stuff that they use in petri dishes.
It's very popular as well. There's a hell of a lot of stuff going on in it. I'm trying to find a video that doesn't have some person talking over it. I would play the game for you. In fact...
So, does it start out like the cellular level of Spore? Is that what you're saying?
Let me just start a game. One second.
A live demonstration.
Yeah. So you're crazy. This little amoeba. I haven't put a name in, but you can have a name on it now. See all these other big amoebas that are around. You can't see any right now. But as you eat the particles, you get bigger and bigger and bigger. Now that guy there, he can eat me because he's bigger than me. That's a real person. Someone playing it. That SH down there, I could probably eat him, but you have to completely engulf them. So that guy there, I've just eaten him. and I got bigger because of it, so I absorbed all of his size, essentially. There was a guy earlier on. There's people on this. There's a person called Google on it a minute ago, which I thought was quite apt. There's a big guy. And if
surprised not coming to get you.
Well, yes, I don't know what the incentive is for people. I don't know why they're not coming to get me. There you go. I just got eaten by someone because I'm dead. That's it. Done. It's really fun though. After I played it for a little bit, I was like, oh my god, I can see the potential here. It does crash every now and again though, like that. Just stops.
It crashes to advertise something to you.
But when you're small,
look out.
When you're small,
TG43.
So a mully box in there.
That's what happens if you split. So you can split. So if I need to be bigger to split, but let me try and find a person who's smaller. So when you split, you reduce by half, but you've got two balls, so that makes you more vulnerable. But splitting allows you to dash at somebody and eat them essentially. So let me try and find a small guy I can do it to. If I can, you see, I'm getting slower and slower and slower as well, though, as I get bigger and bigger. So again, little guys can get away quickly. This guy might split on me. Oh, and after a while as well, you merge back together. I played it for a little bit, and then I started getting a little bit addicted to it, and I was like, oh my god, this is actually quite brilliant.
A web game that I got really addicted to was MMO Bomberman. Did you ever play that?
No.
It's Bomberman, but on giant maps, scrolling maps, and you basically just got hundreds of people running around blowing each other up. It's really good fun.
The last web game I got addicted to was... I've still got my last save from it, actually. It was that... Oh, shit. it was that where you build a fire and you start...
Or a dark room.
A dark room.
Dark room is fantastic.
It
is
wonderful.
One of the best games I've ever played.
Oh, there we go.
And highly recommend that anyone Google.
What is a dark
room? It's almost impossible to describe. It's a game that keeps becoming more of a game the more you play it. It starts off you just clicking a button over and over, and you end up playing this very deep game with a really good narrative, that the world becomes like bigger as you play. It's amazing. It's really difficult to describe. Chris is playing it now.
So you start off with lighting a fire, and it tells you that the light from the fire spills out from the windows out into the dark. The fire is burning, and you have to stoke the fire. Now you're just clicking a button, as Lou said. That's all I'm doing now. Just clicking a button. It's roaring. Brilliant. But eventually people start arriving at your camp, and then you start building
huts.
Don't
spoil it too much,
I'm not
going
to. No, you start building huts, and you start building a little community, but then...
One of the joys of the game is the way the game changes as you play it into a different style of game. And the way that the narrative evolves so that you're not entirely sure what the hell's going on. You're just in a dark room with a fire, and it's beautifully realized. It's it won awards, I think, this game, and it got an iOS port of it. But I highly recommend you to spend an hour or so playing it, because it is really, it's magnificent. It's,
you could spend a lot longer than an hour though as well.
I played it to pretty much completion. I think I've completed it, in fact, and it takes a couple of hours.
I haven't
but
completed
it's so
it.
Worth it.
It's one of those games that I've played quite a few times, but I've never had enough like time to proper dedicate to it that I've there's been other games that I've wanted to play more, you know.
No, see, it's really, really good.
At the moment I'm going back between a forest and a room, and I'm gathering wood occasionally. The room's getting warmer and warmer and warmer, and you have to keep, basically if your fire goes out, the game's over as well.
Right.
That is right, isn't it, Lou?
Pretty much. I think it says you're freezing, and then if you leave it a bit longer than that, you die. Okay. But yeah, it's really, really good. A dark room.
It's
The other game I mentioned is called The Game of Bombs. It obviously changed its name from Bomberman because of some cease and desist, because obviously Nintendo being Nintendo. But that's worth playing as well. That's really good fun.
Yeah. So I've got a save where I'm about maybe an hour into it that I keep meaning to load back up and have a go at that at some point.
It's the sort of game that you should really play in one sitting, I think. If you come back to it, you lose the flow of it.
Yeah.
Mm. So, it looks like, if you stopped halfway through when you came back, it'd be like, what?
There's a rhythm you get into. It's very much a game which kind of rewards repetitive gameplay, but it doesn't feel like a grind.
Let's do our list section. Now, to those of you who are new, because I see there's a few new people in the chat today, for those of you who are new, our list section is just basically a list that we randomly throw at each other, or one of you guys can throw at us, that is essentially favourite things in game or worst things in game. So, worst voice actor, favourite landscape, whatever, you know. I've got a few today, and I'm not sure why Lou's holding that up, but it's the list section of the game, and it's called The Way of the Exploding List.
That hurt.
Go through that stupid rigmarole every time.
Every time, that rigmarole. So I've got a few ideas now. Unless anyone in chat has any ideas for a list, then we'll do one of mine, unless you guys have.
I've got an idea, but I'm happy to do one of yours.
Yeah, I don't think we've done Chris' idea for a while. Let's go for one of yours.
Do one of mine nearly every bloody week, to be fair. Last week we did one that we were just talking about. We were naturally talking about a list section, and it just merged into this bit.
Yeah, we just did it organically.
Yeah. Okay. Favorite sound effect. Individual
have we done this?
Sound effect.
Sure we've done this before as a list.
I don't think we have.
I don't know.
We've done
we
music.
Have, but I've done sound design and things
like that. We've done soundtrack. Yeah, we've done sound design.
Be getting this confused with favorite weapon, because generally my favorite weapons also have my favorite sounds.
Okay. Well, can I start off with my favorite sound effect ever?
Yeah.
The Metal Gear Solid.
Obviously. It is a classic.
That is a good one. Playing through 5 has made me realise, because they kept a lot of the little sound effects, like when you get out of an enemy's area and it clears, it goes, which is what it's done in all the games, which I really like. That just means you're out of danger, like you clear the alert.
Yeah. So go on.
The quad damage sound.
I haven't heard that for so many years, because mine is modified.
It's like, wow.
It's almost impossible to describe what the sound. It's some kind of weird sort of reverb sound. But you know, Trent Reznor came up with it for Quake 1, and it's just amazing.
I think what he's done is he's got a metal table and a metal ruler and twanged it and then put loads of reverb on it.
Something like that. Sound like a kind of tunnel reverb-y effect.
Slowed it down quite a lot as well. It'd be something like that.
It's such an angry sound.
Quad damage.
I think I remember when if you play through Mass Effect and you get some of the biotic powers, some of those have quite cool sound effects. Like I think there's is it the warp one where you sort of throw the thing at them and it sort of goes like boom, like it's like a really cool like bassy space warping sort of sound effect, which I always quite liked. I try to think of other ones that are in like. It's too easy to say Star Wars because those are film sound effects which have just been put in games, so they don't really count.
Okay, so shall we say iconic sound effects then?
Yeah, I like.
So I said the Hadouken from Street Fighter 2.
Well, in terms of iconic sound effects, Zelda's got quite a lot, hasn't it?
Yes, and little jingles as well, but let's stick to sound effects.
Yeah, it's a jingle, isn't it, I guess.
The ring pickup sound from the Sonic series is a fantastic sound. Like, da-ling! That's a really good sound.
And the coins from Mario, you can never da-ding! Deny those. Similar thing.
Very similar. Yeah, it's just two notes instead of three.
Mario's got a lot of those sound effects, like the little, when you get bigger, all the little things which are just like second nature. You hear them, you recognise them so quickly.
The whacka whacka sound from Pac-Man as well.
Yeah.
Whacka 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 whacka.
Constant for hours and hours.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what about dun 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 dun?
Yeah.
Does that count as music or is that a sound effect?
No, because it happens when they move.
It's them moving.
Yeah.
That's the sound of their engines plummeting towards Earth.
A little bit of trivia for that, but the fact that the Space Invaders speed up is not because of an intended game design thing. It's actually because the CPU was under less load. So as you kill more enemies, it can run faster because it's having to display fewer enemies.
Yeah, but ever since then, that obviously is now what happens. So does that not mean that your ship is faster then as well in the original?
I don't think your ship's frame limited.
All right.
But the things falling are faster and the enemies moving are faster.
Interesting.
There's quite a lot of, I think we're talking about weapons. There's quite a lot of sound effects that come with weapons that are really quite satisfying. Like
the Quake 2 double barrel shotgun straight away. That's one of my favourite sounds ever made.
The Doom 2 double barrel shotgun is better. The super shotgun sound is brilliant.
One of the sounds I always liked, and it was happened with the shotgun, but not just the shotgun, because the Magnum did it as well. But when a zombie's head explodes, Resident Evil, it has this sort of like kind of set, like this really sort of painful cracking sort of wet, like a massive egg being shattered sort of kind of sound effect when you blow a zombie's head up. Oh, so good. Never gets old, that one. Actually, I don't think even the modern ones, you don't necessarily get a headshot if you do the shotgun, but in the old games, if you point it up with your shotgun, you blow their head up every time. It was fucking brilliant.
In Quake 3, it introduced a sound effect when you do damage on things from far away, so that you knew you were doing damage. It's like this little nah, sort of noise. Mm. And that grew on me quite a lot. I hated it to begin with, but it's actually so handy.
The original Half-Life weapon change and select sounds. If you remember I can't even do them.
It's a clicky noise, isn't it?
No, it's like a not that. Sorry, that's when you've filled up your.
Yes, I know. Yes, health, I know which one you mean. It's like a little kind of machiny noise, isn't it? Like a little blip noise.
Yeah.
Well, the portal gun's got a nice sound to it as well. That poof share sort of when you shoot it and it goes push up wah, but it opens up the portal on one side.
Hmm.
That's a nice little bit of feedback. Like, it just. And I guess that's what a sound effect's there for, it's to sort of give you that audio feedback that you've done something or that something's happened.
Yeah, I think in first person shooters, especially, or any game where you play online against other people, you start to really pick up on the sounds. and you use them for the gameplay. Like, you listen for respawn sounds. The respawn sounds in games are very familiar, like the Doom sounds, yeah, even the connect and disconnect sounds on Quake 2, this metallic thunk, were really good. And it's amazing how aware you become of the sounds as part of the fabric of the game, in the space that you're in the game.
Yeah.
And aware to the direction and the distance of the sounds.
I said, as you know, someone who used to play you and I, Lou, used to play games in competition, at least, anyway, you do. That's one of the main things in the game, is to, you could tell based on the volume of where the sound was and which sound it was. And in fact, so say for example the weapon pickup sound and the ammo pickup sound is slightly different in Quake 2. So if you hear ammo, gun, ammo, or gun, ammo, ammo, and it's a certain distance away, you know that they're at the rocket area underneath in Quake 2 DM1 because you've heard it so many times before.
Yeah, well, the other one in Quake 2 DM1 is the plop of water sound, which you can only get from jumping in the railgun water. So what some people did was they threw an ammo box in the water, then waited for the other person to come bounding through, ready to shoot them in the water.
Roll them out of the air.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's I played EverQuest a lot, and I really relied on sound in EverQuest because it was a bit laggy, but the sound was pretty good. So you'd be walking up a hill, and you wouldn't be able to see anything going up this hill, but you'd be able to hear the sound of a giant running around or something, or something nasty at the top of the hill.
Mm.
And you'd really be listening out, and I became very aware of how much I was listening in games, and it was really good. It was a really big part of the gameplay. The sounds.
The first Bioshock had that for me as well. It was very important to listen to what was going on before you approached an area. Like, you'd go to an area, and I don't think Infinite did this as much, and I don't remember 2 doing it as much either, where you'd sort of walk into a bit and you might hear a splicer going, oh, da 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 da, and you'd be like, oh, that's in that room over there. And you might hear a big daddy going, over there. So you'd have to sort of get a little bit of a lay of the land, and it also built tension, because you might know, based on what they were saying, what kind of splicer they were, and what you were walking into.
Mm.
Which I thought was really, really well done in that game. The sound design was impeccable.
Yeah.
In that game. It really helped sell the atmosphere, and it made it quite tense and scary. The way that the other games haven't been, really, and not scary the way the first one was. I think the sound design, which is not really a sound effect, but it's the importance of the sound design, was really paramount, I think, to that experience.
I've mentioned this before, but there's a scene right near the start of the original Unreal where you walk up to a door and the door doesn't open fully, and then you hear a load of gunfire and screams and stuff behind the door, and then the door opens all the way and you see a load of jibs fly out and an alien run away. And it's really well done, and it's all done just with a few sound effects and a flash of light.
Hmm.
It works so well.
Well, it's leaving things to your imagination, which again, in a game where it's something you expect to be able to walk up to it and punch it, rather than a film where you're being directed, it's nice that if a game developer can do that, is to not only give you the action and the agency of playing the game, but to also make you use your imagination to make things more scary or intense than it would be if they just shoved the monster in your face.
Which possibly games and all forms of media, in fact, recently, or more commonly, because you can actually physically realise something now, you can just show the monster right from the start, or whatever, people don't really use these little tricks of cheaply fudging it with some sound effects or something to actually get the same, to work on your mental state within whatever it is you're trying to consume. Like, the reason Jaws works so well is because the shark didn't work for most of the movie. It was serendipitous.
It's a shadow in the water and an ominous thought. That's what makes it scary.
Yeah.
It's an unseen threat with teeth. That's enough.
And games do this brilliantly. Even Doom did this so well, when you get the grunts of the monsters far away and stuff. And we were playing Minecraft recently, and that does some really good stuff with sound effects. It has these cavern sounds that play, which spook the shit out of you. When you're near an area where it's in darkness, it plays these ambient sounds, like the sound of like weird supernatural cavey noises, which make you like look around and think, what the fuck was that?
And it's really works well. And there's nothing there either. And then you know again, you get used to when something has spawned, you can hear it, but sometimes they just don't make any noise.
Yeah, like the creepers, which hiss. The only time you know the creeper's there is when it hisses and it's about to explode.
Bastards. Absolutely.
That reminds me of something else from Resident Evil, specifically Resident Evil 2. If you remember playing through the game, either scenario, there are certain points where they have William Birkin is the guy who ends up the big eyeball monster guy. There's bits in the game where you hear him roar from in the distance. And there's a bit where you, if you play as Leon, you go to this prison cell, and there's this guy locked in. He's like, I'm not coming out. Zombies aren't the only things out there. And then you hear like a really horrible roar, and you're like, what the fuck is that? That thing's in here with me. And you don't meet him for like another 45 minutes. And he gets worse and worse as the game goes on. He gets more monstrous. But they set up this idea of this horrible, unseen, scary monster. You only see a bit of his arm or a bit of his leg until you actually meet him. And that's really... Because when you actually do see him, it's a PS1 monster, so he's not that impressive. But the idea that they set up with him makes him very scary, just by having the odd little bit of an angle of his shoulder or his leg and a really cool, horrible roar sound effect, which is just a man's voice processed, but it's well done. It's a really scary
more
sound.
More stuff needs to do that. More stuff needs to do it, definitely.
Mortal Kombat totally. Finish him sound.
Yeah, and many sounds from Mortal Kombat. Dusty!
Yeah.
I've just had I'm afraid I cheated a little bit, and I've just had a look on a few lists. There was one that, Mission Impossible, if you remember that. You remember the very beginning of that game? You'd start the game and it'd say stay around, stay forever, if you remember that.
I didn't play Mission Impossible.
I think it was stay around or stay forever, something like that. And that, when I read that, I was like, God, yeah, I can totally remember that sound effect. It's a good one.
That's more of a line of dialogue. Is that a sound effect or a line of dialogue?
Still a sound effect, isn't it? Well, it's not. There's no other dialogue in that game. That's and it was very, very processed as well. I think it was even done with some kind of sound processor because it was a Commodore 64. So it wasn't a sound. It wasn't a recording of a person. It was synthesized by the chips on the machine.
Have either of you completed Doom 3?
No, I just got scared.
Never even played it.
Right, it's a shame because Doom 3 is a pretty mediocre game. It's scary, but it's pretty mediocre. But the end of the game, the build-up to the end of the game is fantastic, and it's all pretty much done with sound. I'm not probably spoiling anything by saying that your final encounter is with the Cyber Demon.
Right.
Bloody big goat sort of leg thing, fires rockets at you. But you basically descend down into its arena through this hell sort of area, and all you can hear is the footsteps, this big clumping footstep noise, getting louder and louder as you're getting closer, and like this throbbing rumble in your ears. It's really well done. It's the best part of the game.
What about the worms? Anything in Worms? Any of
effects? No, all the stupid chipmunk voices in Worms.
They're all, again, iconic, though. that was a good impression, that, Lou. That sounded perfect.
I liked the newest one, but the worms you could get on Xbox Live and whatnot, where you could hear them different voices. Where you'd have like the movie announcer voice and like, it was a worm who died and stuff like that. Not that was shit, but they'd say better things than that.
That was what was brilliant about the original Worms release, that you could do that. You could, on the Amiga, you could modify all the sounds and, you could change them to actual sound clips as well from, you know, that you not downloaded, but you got from a mate on a disc. I love that.
That just reminded me of that horrible popping sound. You know, when you're playing Lemmings and you were... You give up and they just go.
Oh no!
Yeah. It's that horrible but satisfying at the same time.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Shall we move on?
Yeah, why not? There's still lots of actual sound effects I can think of. Actually,
there is lots and lots of sound effects, but that's the beauty of it. We can always do it again. So, gaming news, rumours, releases, upcoming games, etc., etc. As again we've said, we're not. It's a bit thin on the ground this week, news, but we'll do our best with what I've picked up this week. So last week we announced, Lou will like this. Lou wasn't here for the announcement, but Introversion have finally decided to release a game, and Prison Architect is coming out of early access as of the 6th of October.
I don't think Introversion finished games just get bored of making them.
Well, that obviously we announced. Well, we said that last week, but this week they said that they've brought out the. Bringing out a few extra mods in it or a few extra features. One of them is you can play as a prisoner in Prison Architect, which sounds quite interesting, to be fair.
That's actually in Dwarf Fortress. You can either play Fortress mode or you can play Adventure mode, where you actually play one character adventuring in the world that you've generated.
I forgot to
mention.
So it
sounds like they've taken a leaf from that.
I forgot to mention, I played Dwarf Fortress a few months ago and I had no idea what the fuck was going on.
The learning curve is pretty much vertical.
I started it up. I tried every fucking option in every menu, and there was about 7 billion menus. And I looked up some tutorials online. I couldn't find anything that coherently helped me as a newbie to kind of get me started. I didn't really know what was going on.
I'm posting a link into the chat. There's a PC Gamer did a series on it. It was a bit long-winded and they did loads of them, but the first few are quite good for learning how to play the game.
Right,
and okay. It's a guy who's good at it and a guy who's never played it before, both playing through Dwarf Fortress for the first time.
So, I mean, it's one of those games that I probably enjoy, I think, but I just need to
You would love it. You would love it because the depth of it is unparalleled. There are no games like it, but it's almost impenetrable unless you can get used to the really terrible interface. Hmm. Which often makes no sense.
No, I mean, the press G to...
It'll be a different key depending on which menu you're on and stuff that. It's crazy. And there's like 5 different ways that you can use cursor keys and different keys to do cursor-like things depending on what board you're in and stuff. It's bonkers.
I was moving a dude around in a forest at one point, but I didn't know if I was expending points by doing it. I don't know what
You don't move things in Dwarf Fortress unless you play in adventure mode. Which is a roguelike.
I don't know.
If you play Fortress mode, you don't move anything. You just tell things what to do, and they'll do it in their own time.
Right.
Just like Dungeon Keeper.
Okay.
So you don't mind the walls. You tell which walls you want mining, and then they'll get round to it.
Right. I don't know. I'm sure I was. Maybe it was a cursor I was moving around then. I don't know. Okay, so they've got this new in this Prison Architect. It's coming out. I'm quite looking forward to playing the final version because it's going to have a fully finished single player as well, with quite a few acts in it, which I've been looking forward to because I quite enjoyed the single player that I did play when I first played the game, and it broke when the first couple of times I played it, so I couldn't really get past a certain point. So I'm looking forward to finishing that off at least. The Beginner's Guide is a new game, a new narrative video game by the creators of the Stanley Parable. Now, this is only because I replayed the Stanley Parable recently. I saw this and it interested me.
That's tomorrow, isn't it?
Well, I don't know, actually.
Thursday, October the 1st.
Oh, cool. Right, well, they've got a blank website at the moment. So I think I'll be grabbing that when it comes out, just because I enjoy the Stanley Parable so much, and if they can do as good a job at the narrative, I'd be quite interested in that. Latest Humble Bundle came out yesterday or today, and there's quite a lot of games on it that I've been looking at for a while, and I've been going, I quite fancy that, but I'm not sure I want to buy it, you know? Like, for example, Sir, You Are Being Hunted, which is a game...
Got that.
Have you played it?
I've played it, yeah.
It's a game that's... Essentially, you are a human that's been hunted by robots, as far as I can tell. But it's in kind of a steampunk, futuristic, cartoony kind of countryside setting, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a stealth game.
And it's a stealth roguelike, apparently, isn't it?
It's a randomly generated stealth game. I wouldn't call it a roguelike.
It's indie as well as...
To be fair, I was actually really interested in this when it was being developed, but I was interested in the way that they designed the procedural generation, the countryside generation, which was meant to generate random English countryside, was really interesting. But the game itself is a little bit weak.
Well, that's one of the things that when I was looking at it, thinking, it looks like a game that I might play, but I don't really particularly want to play, pay for it right now. Obviously, there's a tutorial by the looks of it, etc. But Yeah, I'm... anyway, I've grabbed that. There's another game called Cube Director's Cut, which again has been out for... All these games have been out for quite a while, and it looks like it's a kind of a psychological puzzler in some way. I don't really know the concept, but I've liked the look of the kind of release videos for a while. And they're... It's a puzzler. Anyway, quite looking forward to that. Planetary Annihilation, which we've talked about before.
I really so wanted to like that game, but it's just not anywhere near as good as Supreme Commander.
Have you played it then, I'm presuming?
I haven't played it, but I've seen it being played, and I just can't get into it at all. I can't even watch it being played. It's too close to being Supreme Commander, but not.
Right.
And it's just the it's hard to tell what the hell's going on in it. It's just not as well made, and it's reflected in the fact that people are still playing Supreme Commander rather than playing Planetary Annihilation.
Isn't it an
The best thing about that game was it was crowdfunded. It was a Kickstarter.
Right.
But it's just not as good as games that came out many years ago.
So the unique concept is that you are on a planet and you fight other planets. Yeah, by the looks of it.
You can all be on the same planet, but you can actually you play in an entire solar system, and you can actually attach rockets to asteroids and drive those asteroids into other planets and stuff. So right. It's like taking the large scale warfare of Supreme Commander and making it planetary, although it doesn't feel as large scale as Supreme Commander, ironically.
No.
Because the units are quite big, the planets are quite small. When you play a big Supreme Commander game, it is enormous. It feels like a war. This doesn't really feel like that. It feels a bit like Spore, in that the planets are exaggeratedly small.
See, I don't think I'd mind that, because I find that other one that you were talking about,
Supreme Commander.
Supreme Commander. I found Supreme Commander 2, anyway, quite...
No, just don't talk about Supreme Commander 2, because it's not really... It's not the same game at all.
Right, okay. So anyway, I played 2. I'm going to talk about it because it's the only one I've played. And it felt way too complicated for me, way too micromanaging for my liking. And I prefer, when I play my RTSs, I prefer my kind of scaled back a little bit, I think. So maybe I would enjoy this, I don't know, if it's not as complicated.
It is complicated. It does retain the hallmarks of the Total Annihilation style mass warfare thing. It just doesn't do it as well as Supreme Commander did it. Supreme Commander Forge Alliance, the add-on, is as close to a perfect RTS as you're likely to get, I think.
Right.
But it's very hard to get into. It's a very demanding game that requires a lot of your time.
Fair enough. Anyway, I'm glad I've got it, because I've been on my watch list for a while, you know. Xenonauts.
Yep,
which I definitely want to play, and you said that you played it a while back and you really liked it.
Yeah,
but you're going to tell me otherwise now, aren't you?
No. The only reason I haven't played it more is the fact that it doesn't really offer that much more than the original XCOM did. So if you've completed and played to death the original XCOM, it's just a rehash of that, which is great if you've not played the original XCOM and you can't get away with the old graphics. And it does add things to it. It just doesn't add enough to it to warrant it being a game that I would play again for a long period of time. So I'd highly recommend it to people who've not played the original XCOM to death.
See, I haven't played XCOM to death. I've played a bit, but not loads. So it's essentially a management sim, isn't it? You manage your base and you manage your resources, etc., and then you send out your soldiers on missions, but there's a lot of other management-y stuff going on as well, isn't
there? That's exactly right, yeah. I mean, the missions, you can bring back materials from the missions and then research them and sell them and use them to better equip your soldiers. It's set in the 60s as well. It's got quite an interesting setting. It's like all kind of Cold War era stuff with alien invasion.
Is it a remake, or is it just a spiritual successor?
It's almost entirely a remake of the original XCOM. Like, the mechanics are very, very similar to the original XCOM. I think it's some frustrated people wanting a modern XCOM, And they didn't really get that from the remake of XCOM, because the remake of XCOM isn't really the same game. Whereas
I imagine it's quite a lot simpler, the remake of XCOM.
It is, yeah.
So
whereas this has got the same level of detail as the original XCOM.
Okay. So because you're...
It's a great game.
I'm going to say, because you would only recommend it to people who haven't played XCOM, simple as that.
Yeah, because I think anyone who's played the original XCOM will have played it enough to have got their fill from it, and this doesn't offer anything new.
Right. Okay, well, good for me. Lastly, there's a few other things on the Humble Bundle as well, but lastly is Gang Beasts, which I've again had my eye on for a while. I saw it at a convention ages ago. It's an indie game, and you play as these kind of Play-Doh characters, and the game I played was multiplayer, and it was played in many different, like, you could play on streets, you could play it in a meat grinder factory, but essentially you threw each other around, and you it's just really fun to play multiplayer. I'm going to show a video of it because it explains it better than I can. But the guys who did it as well, they were quite friendly, etc. Let's have a look. If anything loads up, everything's really slow at the moment.
What kind of game is it in general?
So it's like a brawler. They originally created it as a... They were going to do a single-player story for it, but it ended up just being like an arena brawler, and you control these little Play-Doh characters that you can probably see there. And the intention is for you to throw people off platforms, punch people until they're dead, you know, etc. But it's because they've got loads of ragdoll physics in there.
Yeah, it kind of feels like a physics test that someone kind of put together and then realised they could beat the shit out of each other with.
And it was, yeah.
And the game's evolved from that.
They put it together, and because they're an indie studio, again, they didn't have the time to animate everything, so they just threw a load of... Play-Doh kind of ragdolls together, and yeah, it kind of evolved into this fighting game. But they did intend to fully intend to have a full story and a full kind of loads of different areas and arenas, but they just ended up building loads of simple arenas that are actually a lot of fun to play in. There's a boxing ring as well you can play in. There is one of the original streets that they designed as well. Everything's really plain and simple, but anyway, this is still in early access, but I'm looking forward to playing it. I've played it a while back and enjoyed it. And it's one of those games, I think, at a LAN, it'd be a lot of fun with mates, you know, on the same screen. Because I think it requires that as well. I think it requires you to be on the same screen. It's not really.
And God bless local multiplayer, because we need more of that shit, don't we?
We do.
We definitely need more of that shit.
We need to finish Charnhell and get that actual fun, making that actual fun.
Yeah.
With controls that make sense to people.
Yeah, but the game that makes sense to people, let's be fair.
Yeah. Okay, so we talked about the Metal Gear Solid 5 save breaking bugs. There's a new one that's come out, which is, if it's only on PlayStation and it doesn't affect you, Sam. And well, it might affect you actually if your sisters are playing it and they've got accounts on your PlayStation.
They don't have accounts on that.
Okay, so that basically, if you've got more than one PSN account on your PlayStation and you flip between them, apparently you can receive an error occasionally, and that if you receive that error will be a save-breaking bug and you can no longer load your saves. They said they're working on it as a high priority, but it's just one of those things I think that's in the news today and it's probably worth mentioning if no one's come across it before. MGS Online is launched on the 6th of October, which is the same day that Prison Architect is launched, so I don't know what they're going to do about it, because it's obviously going to compete quite heavily. And it sounds interesting. I'm not sure I'm going to bother with it, though.
Some of the Metal Gear Online stuff looks like it could be quite interesting, just because there's some little mechanics that they've put in there that I quite like the idea of. Like, there's a buddy system, because you know how in the one-player game you've got your buddies that you take with you? When you've got a team in Metal Gear Online, you can signal to another person. This could be somebody that you know or a randomer. And you can say, like, you do a salute, and then if they salute back, you're then buddies. Which means that you then, whenever they tag somebody, you
you get to see it as well, all that kind of stuff. And even though you're on a team, you have a more closely knit thing with one other person if you buddy with them, and you can change that whenever you want as well, which is pretty cool.
Does this play out obviously, a bit like Grand Theft Auto, like in you've got like many people on an open world?
No, it looks like, from what I've seen, I don't know, from what I've seen, it looks like they've actually got specially designed maps that you play missions on rather than the open world. I don't know about that for sure, just because the bit of gameplay that I saw looked like a bespoke area that was made for playing multiplayer in. It wasn't a huge open area. That could have just been that they'd gone to an area and then done a mission there, like in Grand Theft Auto. But I'm not sure about that yet. It looks like it's not that way. It looks like you actually load into a level and do a multiplayer mission on that level rather than just wandering around the map shooting each other aimlessly.
I'll get my a bit of a go.
Unlike Grand Theft Auto, there are two distinct open world sections in Metal Gear, so you'd have to then pick which one, Afghanistan or Africa. So I don't know how that would work. So it might be that they just let you do levels. I sort of wait when it comes out. I don't have an online subscription for my PlayStation yet, and nothing I've seen so far has made me want to fork out the money to get one. So we'll see.
I'll see. I might have a go, see what it's like. Last time I tried to play Metal Gear Online, I think it was Metal Gear Solid 4, potentially 3. One of them, anyway. And I didn't get on with it at all. It wasn't particularly fun playing stealth against other people, but they've probably refined it quite a lot now.
Doesn't strike me as the sort of game that really warrants being made online. It sounds like that's a bit of an arbitrary decision to kind of extend the life of it.
Indeed.
Yeah, well, we'll see when it comes out. It could be cool. It looks like it could be quite good fun, but I'm not bothered about it. The one player game is why I bought it, and the one player game is what I'm enjoying. So.
Exactly. So on that note, we shall close the show unless you guys have anything else you want to talk about.
I already brought up the cut content for Metal Gear earlier, which is the only other thing, but we already talked about it when we talked about the game. But basically, a lot of fans are talking about it, and speculation has come up as to whether this is going to be paid DLC at some point, because apparently they've cut out missions affect the ending of the game, and people are saying that the ending we've got isn't the true ending and blah blah blah. I don't know, I haven't finished it yet, and that article that I put in there is, it's got no story spoilers in it, it's just saying that there are people kicking off about the fact that there's cut content from the release of the game, and they're not really sure who's to blame for it.
Right, there could be reasons for it to do with Kojima leaving and, you know, all that malarkey that's been going on, but really, I mean, who are these people that complain about these endings and things? I mean, their ending to Mass Effect 3 is still controversial. They even patched it, didn't they, and gave you a different ending, but didn't people still weren't happy about
it? Well, it was a little
underwhelming. It's not your game. Yeah, but it's not your game. Get on with it. You've enjoyed the ride there, haven't you? You've enjoyed the gameplay. Why does everything have to be perfect and match exactly what your expectations are going to be? I'm fine with the ending of Mass Effect 3.
There's a difference between setting up... In the Mass Effect 3 case, the problem is that they said from the get-go, your decisions matter, like your decisions will affect the outcome of everything. And ultimately, the minutiae of your decisions, whether you chose to save the Rachni or not, that didn't matter in the end because you got three different coloured explosions. That was really all you got at the end. So the fact that they kind of sold it a little bit as a lie is, I think, more the issue then. If they just said, look, you play a game and it's got, you start out here, you branch out decisions here and you end here, then everyone would have been fine. That you've already written an ending, we'll go along with that. But I think they said that they were going to do these multiple, you know, wildly various like story branching ideas that you can affect the story. And people were pissed off because you couldn't really affect the story. You could affect little bits of it on the way, but the end game of the story, how the Reapers were defeated, kind of was a little last-minute decision with three different coloured explosions. That's basically what it was. That was why people were pissed off about it. As for the cut content in Metal Gear Solid 5, they're saying that that extra mission or whatever it is, it has the real conclusion to the game. And if that is the case, then that might be an issue to be annoyed about, but I haven't completed it yet, so I don't know what the ending is or anything to do with that. if there's certain, because in Peace Walker there were certain criteria you had to do on earlier missions to get the proper ending, and I don't know if it's going to be the same in this one, so I don't know.
Well, you can retry missions, can't you? So you can complete them all if you really want in exactly the right
way
you
need
to.
Yeah, exactly.
But I haven't heard anything that they're touting this as a multiple ending game, or it's got different outcomes depending on what you do in the game.
Yeah, I don't think it has. None of the Metal Gears have been multiple ending games. They've been a set story that you just happen to take part in.
I don't think I'd be sold by that either. If that was something they're trying to sell, you know,
it's not the way, is it? It's like doing multiple endings in Zelda. I don't want that in that franchise. It's not for every franchise. The same way that
saves the princess. It doesn't save the princess.
Yeah, the same way we talked about with L.A. Noir, it's like, why was that game open world? Open world doesn't fit everything. Mm. They have actually done it quite well in Metal Gear, but they probably could have done it not open world if they really wanted to.
There is a lot of time filling, but it's fun time filling, so I don't have a problem with it, really. It's like why I enjoyed The Witcher, you know, because even the side quests I enjoyed doing, and I enjoyed all of the little stories and all of the little filler material.
And the exploration is nice in games like that as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so thank you very much, everybody, for watching. We shall see you next Wednesday, or maybe in a few weeks, depending on how things go. Thanks for watching, and we shall see you later.
See you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.